Okay, date is Thursday, October the 1st, 2015. This is the Northampton Council on Aging, Northampton Senior Services Board Meeting. Public session is our first on the agenda. We have no member of the public here, so we'll go to the minutes of September 10th. Would someone like to make a motion? John? And second Barbara? John made the motion and Barbara seconded it. Is there any problem with any of the minutes? Any corrections? No? Okay, then all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Matter passes. Okay, we'll go to the staff report. Heather King Lane, Program Coordinator, is here.
Hi, everybody. It's been kind of a while, I think since February, since I've been at the board meeting. So I'll just tell you about a few things that are going very well or that happened in the spring. Some upcoming classes and programs we have, and a little bit about our trips and travel program that is finally back on its feet. So a few highlights from the spring. We had a stargazing class with a retired professor from Holyoke Community College. We had small attendance, but it went very well. It went so well that one of the members actually is still stargazing with the instructor. They go together to, I think, Chesterfield, and they go stargazing. So that was a very popular class in the spring. Something we'd like to try again, so if you're interested, let me know. We also had a wonderful play called Tea for Three with actress Elaine Broca, sponsored by Calvin Coolidge. We had 135 people attend the play, so that was definitely one of the highlights of the spring. We also had some of the more traditional stuff, watercolors class. We partnered with the food bank, and they did a healthy eating and living presentation that was very popular. The food bank will actually be back in October to do a healthy eating with diabetes class, as well as a grocery store tour at Stop and Shop. That you have to sign up for, and you get a free $10 gift card. You get tips on how to shop for healthy foods at the grocery store, so we're working with the food bank on some things like that. We also started a meditation class on Monday afternoons at 1:30. Kind of got off to a slow start, but now we have some regular participants. They're really enjoying the class, and it's open to anyone, people who have never meditated before in their life. So it's a very welcoming atmosphere. Some upcoming classes for October and November. We're going to have an African dance class. We had a demo over the summer, and that had quite a few participants. So we'll be starting a class October 27th. We have a beginning conversational Spanish class that will begin October 27th. A line dancing class that will begin October 21st. This will be dances to songs from '30s to the '80s, including big band music, Broadway hits, rock and roll, and country western, so that should be a lot of fun. We'll have a felting your knits class. If you don't know anything about felting and you're interested, we're doing a free demonstration on October 13th, so you can see that and then sign up for class. A few things we've been doing on a monthly basis are some financial education presentations. We've had a lot of support from members of the community, Edward Jones, Chris Casal, an independent financial advisor. People have been very generous in donating their time to share financial education. If you ever have any topics you feel that we need to be covering, please share them with me, because they're happy to cover anything. We also started an Author of the Month program, where we have a local author come in and do a reading, question and answer session from their book. So this started in September with Harriet Rogers, and will continue in October with author Sue Mack with her memoir about having amnesia. So that was very popular for the first one, and hope it continues. Cooking with Sherry will be back on October 29th. This has been very popular in the past. Sherry was an innkeeper and chef, and now she's donating her time, and she makes delicious food. Bob loves when she comes, because we always sample it. So the participants help to prepare the meal, and then they all sit and eat together family style, so it's a really wonderful morning. Some special events coming coming up. Our concert in November by Skylars. The concert will be November 9th, and it will be free to people with a stand card, $2 for anyone else. And some fall and Halloween crafts with Linda Manor. This will be free as well with some light refreshments. Just get into the fall spirit now that the weather feels like fall. And last but not least, our trips and travel program is back up and running and is going very well. We've gone to Connecticut for a rail and sail tour. We did a Newport trip, amazing Newport, and we just did the Biggie last week. So we've got wonderful feedback on all the trips. We have a trip to Boston coming up next week. Barb is going on it. They're going to be going on the duck boat tour. There will be a tour of the Sam Adams Brewery, lunch in Boston, so it should be a good day. We also have a Rockettes trip to the November 20th that was very popular, and it's on a wait list only. And then in December, we'll go to Foxwoods to see Grammy Award winning artist Lee Greenwood and his Tennessee Christmas show at the Fox Theater. So those are some upcoming things, as well as a Boston flower show in March. So we're getting the paperwork together on that. And they'll be planning, hopefully, the entire next year and keep trips and travel going in a great direction. So those are sort of the highlights. I could talk to you forever and ever about all the cool things we're doing, but those are the highlights. Does anyone have any questions?
Heather, can you just mention about the jazz concert that was here?
Oh, yep. We had Rockbridge came in, and they sponsored a jazz concert. The group was called Fun Stuff with Zach. I know some of you know Zach from his performance at Holiday Dinner. But they did a wonderful concert with refreshments. Rockbridge came in, they brought shrimp and these wonderful peaches wrapped in bacon with a balsamic glaze. It was sort of a fancy and fun afternoon at the Senior Center. So we hope to have a few more events like that.
I said we'll never see shrimp here again. Unless it was a one and only time.
Rockbridge may come back with something, I don't know.
Yeah, Rockbridge and Calvin Coolidge and Linda Manor and Jaime have all been very generous and helping us out.
They're competing,
I think they are.
Yeah. And Christopher Heights now as well.
Yeah, Christopher Heights is starting to get involved. They're all helping to sponsor a travel lecture series for the fall and winter. They've been very generous.
Appreciate it.
Very good, Heather.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Comments? Okay, we'll move on to finances, the FY16 budget.
So in looking at the sheet, because we still have funds in our personal services and our maintenance account, which is good. So you know, we're just at the beginning points of our budget building. And you know, just remind everyone that through our revolving accounts, we in May start transferring monies into our city account to pay for our portion of what we owe for personnel. So that happens later in the year. So the annual appeal is currently going on, so 2015 is still happening, and to date we've received 4,581. This is one of our bigger ways to raise funds for our programming, or our needs, I should say, opportunities, initiatives of the Senior Center. And I've mentioned previously that we're already getting ready for the 2016 annual appeal. The Board of Registrars approved our letter, not our letter, but our envelope going into the census mailer. And that's sent out by the city clerk's office, registrar's office, to every household in Northampton to gather the census data. So we're fortunate, and we have been for a number of years, been able to have our envelope in there. The only cost of the annual appeal to us is purchasing the envelopes. So. That's what the annual appeal is, and it's beneficial to our budget. That's what I have.
Okay, one question. I noticed we have one negative here on the office supplies. Mm-hmm.
We bought a whole lot of supplies ahead and kind of know the budget.
Well, within the OM account, you can, you, let's say we don't use everything in professional technical services. So the bottom line is we can't spend over $10,264. So the need for office supplies. We are planning trainings for all the volunteers, so we ordered a lot of binders.
So we made up from what you don't spend in public.
And another account, yeah.
Okay, no problem.
Anywhere, you know, for contractual services or technical services. I hope we don't really have anything that breaks down or, you know, the cleaning that we have to do, required by law to do once a year with the vent fan. So, you know, that's a given, but then, like the ice machine had to have a repair, so that's, I'll guess $350 for that to be repaired. So it could end up that technical services, more than 2,000 is used, but maybe not. And, you know, advertising, maybe that isn't all the total amount. And so one account will cover the other, as long as we don't exceed $10,264. And that covers all the needs of our budget. And I'm just gonna remind everyone that at one point we had $650 when we first opened this senior center that was provided to us from the city for any needs that we had. So thank goodness we had the opportunity through fees, through donations, through rentals, all the other ways that we are able to generate revenue to do what we need to do here at the senior center. I mean, we're thankful for what we get from the city, because it's important, you know, that we do get funding from the city, but not all of our funding comes from the city to do what we need to do here. And, you know, in talking to a lot of people, and I know other board members and people in the community, you know, are surprised that all the money isn't from the city. But when you're in human services, typically you aren't funded by one source. You're out looking for ways that are gonna provide revenue your programs and your services.
Okay, any questions or comments? I'll move on to the director's report.
Yep. So at the last meeting, there was, you know, I had talked about the EOEA grant, and that grant is through the Department of Elder Affairs. It's called the Formula Grant, and the dollar amount is $9 per senior. I think when I first started, it was maybe $4. It was a very minimal amount. So each year through the legislature, there, and MCOA really advocates for an increase each year for the dollar amount, which the legislature approves, times whatever your senior population is. And our population for seniors is 5,874, and that's based on the 2000 federal census. And that's how in Massachusetts the formula grant is derived for each community. The next federal census will be, I'm sorry, it was 2010, I apologize.
I was gonna say, that's fine.
In 2010. But in 2000, the population of Northampton for seniors went down. So not only did the dollar amount go down, so did the number of seniors. So the Council on Aging got hit two ways. Irene was here, so the amount went down. So 2010 was the last federal census, and then the next one will be 2020. And it'll be, as I mentioned numerous times, that the senior population in Northampton is growing because we have a number of assisted livings that are expanding or being built or are built, and now we have that population that can fill the rooms. And I just wanted to thank everyone for switching the meeting. I know in talking to Bob, October 1st, so thank you for being able to fit this in your schedule, because three staff will be going to the MCOA, Massachusetts Councils on Aging Conference. It's a yearly conference. This year it's in Sturbridge. So three of us will be going to that, and it's gonna be on Thursday as well next week. So thank you for that. I don't know if I've mentioned in the past, there's a new newsletter out, Community Connections by the Ahern Funeral Home. I don't know if you've seen these. We have a lot of them here, and I know that they put them out in the community. And this was their first one, summer 2015, and they highlight various organizations, and again, this was their first one, and we were selected to be in here. So it's titled Stargazing Fitness Programs and Tap Dancing, Oh My. So there's pictures of our senior center programs in here and just a lot of information. And I believe there's more left on the round table. They could be gone by now, but you could always look at this. So I thought that was a nice thing to be able to be part of.
Yes.
So, you know, we're always looking at ways to connect with the community and to get our program ideas out there.
When they're available, where are they available?
Do you know that, Mike?
Where can we pick one up when the next issue comes out?
You just want a copy of that.
Is there going to be another issue?
Yes.
And then where will they be available to the public to get? Well,
we'll get some, we'll bring them down here.
Okay.
Are you all of those now?
I have to look on the table, and thank you, Mary. Yeah.
Well, I can get some more and bring them down.
But are they available other places too, Mike?
Yeah. I don't know exactly where they're.
Gotcha. Okay.
I can pass this one around at least. Last week, Crystal and I attended the RSVP luncheon. We have many volunteers here who have signed on to also being an RSVP luncheon. And we have a few claims to fame here. Mary and Dennis Daniels, who are volunteers with us and have been since the early, I'll say 2000. And Dennis a little while after that. I did a presentation for Mary Daniels, who received the President's Service Award for Lifetime Achievement. So I said a few words about Mary for all that she did for us, but Mary is very involved with many other volunteer organizations. And then someone else did the presentation for Dennis, her son, who received the same Presidential Service Award. So it was nice that they were both honored for all the work that they do, and we're, you know, honored and proud that they are part of our senior center volunteer workforce. I had my third and last informational planning session for the LGBT elders. And what's going to happen in the future is four times a year, there'll be an information planning session. Otherwise, you know, programs are being set up. And I mentioned at the last meeting, there's going to be a games night October 29th, and then there's going to be a potluck for LGBT elders November 18th. October 9th, the health department will be here, the Northampton Health Department, to do a flu clinic, so 10 to 12. If you're interested, you should come on down. Just bring your insurance card with you. You don't need to register. Just come down, and I would say come down at 10 o'clock.
I just crossed a lady the other day. Very happy to hear that. She works at a little restaurant up on Maple Street in Florence.
Tobin
Manor? No, not Tobin, the other little small one.
The Valley, River Valley Restaurant? Yeah, on Pine Street.
And she, I gave her the thing, I reminded her the thing. She said, well, how old do you have to be? I said, 16. Oh, she said, that's good, I'll go down.
So people should come. I mean, it's always very popular.
Yeah.
Excuse me, but isn't the flu clinic open to anyone?
Yeah.
You don't have to be
16. Oh, you don't? Well, it's not for seniors.
No, it's open to everybody.
Okay.
The flu vaccine
is right. Oh, in that case, I'll amend my comments, but she's still welcome.
Her and much more.
Her and much more.
We're such an inclusive environment.
And they're also going to be offering other shots as well. So it's good to have the Board of Health do that.
Yep.
And they are looking for volunteers.
And I asked that in the
church because I went to the store to get it.
And yes, it is extra.
It is.
Quite
but they didn't have it either. And I had a terrible time getting it. Well, have the doctor really say that's what I was supposed to get, because one had one type of a shot, the regular, and the other had the stronger shot for the senior citizens.
We have a stronger shot.
And then last year, yeah, we didn't have it.
Well, they took your feedback and they got it done. Thank you, Teresa.
So that's October 9th, 10 to 12. Then they need volunteers, so anybody who, I know Barbara, you're going to volunteer, so they are looking for other people, and it will be held here at the senior center in this room. We had the Mass Impact Day. That's when students from UMass are all over the area doing volunteer work, so this was the third year that we've had them here. That was on Saturday, the 26th. We had 7 students from UMass who did a variety of jobs in the building. They were here from 9:30 to about 2:45, and just kept doing a lot of, and I'll say cleaning, they did a lot of cleaning. And some students went out to seniors' homes. One group went and did plant weeding and gardening. Another did windows, painting the door and painting the cabinet. So they were out in the community at 4 different seniors' homes.
Nice girls.
Yeah.
The two of them.
It was great having them because we got a lot of things really cleaned. Used a lot of Windex. A lot of paper towels.
You should have signed up.
Well, yeah, and I'm sure they'll do it again next year, and you know, so the whole thing about going to seniors' homes might catch on more, because we'll have something in the Con Street Chronicle that will talk about the program and who did what, you know, that'll spark interest for next year. So we're glad to be part of that. There's actually one student, she's been a volunteer, she picks here, and this was her third year doing it, so she's been here every single year. September 12th, we had our shred day, Saturday, September 12th, and we made a little over $1,000 for that shred day, and that's the most we've ever done. It was a very active day, and it was fun. It wasn't too hot, and again, Valley Green shredding does the shredding at no cost to us, is so we can gain revenue for our budget. So we're appreciative of that. Yeah, this year they had bags that could be purchased, and the bag, I think it's 40 pounds, but yes, it was pretty big. And a lot of people had purchased those. Unfortunately, we ran out of them because the Valley Green ran out of them. So we're thinking in the future, because they're usually here twice a year, that in the future we'll have the bags available sooner. And again, it was a new concept. And it was so much easier taking out one of these 40-pound bags, because people really stuff stuff in. It was easier doing that than taking out a lot of other kinds of bags and boxes. And there's not, once you have the bag, you just throw the bag into the container, and then the container gets puts the shredding in.
Does the contents, do they stay in the bag?
Well, yeah, the bags that we sell, yeah.
The bag is shredded with everything else.
Okay.
Yeah, but you know, if somebody brings stuff in plastic bags or trash bags, those bags, they usually dump the contents into the container. So it goes into this big container, and then that container is what gets dumped into the shredding truck.
Could you use a leaf bag?
What's that?
Could you use a leaf bag? You could sell those.
No, the plastic. You don't want to shred the plastic.
No, this
oh,
is
the leaf bag.
Leaf bag. They're paper.
Oh, are they?
And they stand on this side.
I haven't had a husband with leaves for a long time.
Yeah, I don't know that. All I know is that the leaf bag is much thicker, and I don't know if that has anything to do with it, because people shred all thicknesses of paper. But we can investigate that.
If there was, so the bag has to be able to be shredded.
This particular bag had to be shredded. But if you brought a grocery bag of stuff you wanted shredded, that would go right into the container, and all that would be shredded.
It's only because of, say, in the 40 pounds, the pellet bags are 40 pounds. And I don't know what a lot of people do with their excess pellet bags.
Are those like cloth?
No, the plastic, the plastic.
I don't think that can go through.
I think the best thing is to do what we did this year, was to sell them from the company, and there's no question of what they go into.
But I'll check on the, I'll check on whatever kind of bags.
People also bring their own individual containers, actually, and if they can't shred it, they dump it into the, it's a big trash can that uses, that fits on the truck and goes in. So he dumps that in there, he can't shred the whole bag.
Yeah.
I usually buy mine in paper bags, so it was easy.
Yeah.
It was $5 a bag again, a small bag.
The bag, the individual bags or boxes were $5.
But the big bag?
The big bag's $10. Five of it goes to us, and it's five to the company.
Well, I suppose you really wouldn't want to take away, the company's already doing an awful lot for you.
Oh, yeah.
So you would want to continue to buy the bags on there.
But I think the key is that we need the bags ahead of time. As I said, we weren't able to get more bags, and there were a lot of people looking for the bags. It is a really convenient way to get rid of it.
It's also a savings, too, because you can't put 40 pounds in two small bags.
Right, that is true, it's a savings.
And that $5 a piece, that's near $10.
Yeah.
Because when you get a bargain, basically.
Yeah.
Right, and I will say that people fill those bags.
Yeah.
Way beyond the line. I mean, it was like taking out a body bag. It was much more convenient using those bags, I think, to get rid of things, so.
Pastor.
On Tuesday, October 6th, which is next Tuesday, at 3:30, at the farmer's market behind Thorns, the Secretary of the Executive Office of the Elder Affairs is going to be here, Secretary Bonner, or Bonner, I'm not even sure how her name is pronounced. I'll say Secretary Bonner, is going to be at the farmer's market, and the idea is to encourage seniors to eat healthy and buy food products, vegetables, fruits, jams, those sorts of things from farmer markets, because it's fresh and local. And so at 3:30, she will be there, and we're going to have a table with our stuff. We are asked to participate, so we actually are one of the multitude of sponsors for this. We're trying to get an instructor to do a class there, so. Could be Tai Chi or Feldenkrais, I'm not sure. We're just trying to get somebody so that there's some activity as well. But everybody is encouraged to come on down and to participate and maybe buy some fresh vegetables or your pumpkins for the fall. That's everything that I have on my director's report.
Any questions or comments? Okay, we'll move on to buildings and grounds.
Well, everybody's been asking about the two signs that now are outside at the beginning of, I'm going to say, McDonald Way, and over here at the end of our parking area that says Butch McDonald Way. And those aren't our signs, those must have been put up by the Housing Authority. They were up for a few, I'll say weeks, but cardboard was on them. The cardboard has since been taken down. And everyone keeps asking me who Butch McDonald was, and I thought, well, maybe Mike, you might know who, he must have worked for the Housing Authority, and I don't know his position, what he did.
Could he be the person that they made McDonald's house after?
Administration down there now, so. Wait and see.
Yeah, well, I'll find out because I'm curious. But we always, I always knew it was McDonald Way. A lot of people didn't even know that that had a name. So it was kind of interesting and nice to see that they marked it. And it is a private way that belongs to the Housing Authority. Mm-hmm. So.
Is that a speed limit posted for that private way? Sometimes people come off of the street very, very fast.
I think based on, according to remembering what we did for driver's education, and if houses are so close together, there's a speed limit for that. So what it is, I don't know. I don't think it's posted. I think if anything is posted, don't park here all the way down Fruit Street, and it's a bus stop.
A sign maybe just indicating seniors are here, and slow down, seniors present, or something of that nature.
Yeah.
I've seen those signs.
As opposed to kids.
They do for children.
And they do for children, I've seen it around senior centers.
I think there's one somewhere out here. Seniors or, yeah, there is one out there. Well, I think, again, a number of people have continually, and some of you here have said the same thing, that, you know, there really needs to be three stop signs out there. And, you know, it has been investigated with the DPW, and we had different city councilors, but it's not warranted. So, but it is true, people are on Full Street and they just come barreling down and go right through.
If they go and do Mount Salem, they just go right straight through. I stop at that no matter what. No stop sign, but I stop anywhere.
Yeah, I do too.
And then look. It's just safer.
I called at least a year ago, and I was told that there was no, for it to happen. It was almost like we're waiting for something to happen and then look at the sign. In so many cases, but that's the issue that we haven't talked to.
So go lay down and not honk.
We can get a few of them to lay down.
We can all lay down. Several of us could.
Yeah, yeah, you have to have a group there.
What? She got it, she got it, she got it.
This is a numbers game.
So a number of people have also commented about not knowing that this is the senior center because of the signage. And when the building was built, it does say Northampton Senior Center up above the doors. You can't really see them, and they're also stainless steel, which, you know, isn't the most visible. And that wasn't selected by our building committee. So people have suggested, and I do agree and have, checked on things over the years, about having another kind of sign in the ground, like a lawn sign of some sort. Could be lit, could be not, but it would be out front so that people would know that it's the senior center. So I'm going to investigate that a little more, and it could be paid from the gift account. There's a few other things from the gift account too. In a number of gifts in there have been made in memory of someone, so we're going to look at using that money beyond the van.
Another comment that I heard made by one woman who was a stranger in the area, came down Old South Street, saw the sign on Fruit Street that said Senior Center this way, drove down, got here, and wasn't sure what building it was, but kind of figured the tall one wasn't it, so maybe this was it, because there is no sign on the back.
Yeah, that's true.
And that's another area that I, modest sign on the building would be nice. And that'd be too big, but just something to say, Senior Center.
We do have a number 67 that we put on in the front and in the back, because a lot of people come here that are delivering to Walter Salvo and come here instead, even with the number, so. They just know it, and people who come for jobs that are for Highland Valley come here, and it's, they're over there, so.
Another thought could be the sign could be a message board as well. November 14th, our craft fair, blah, blah,
Like the one that's in front of the high school.
Yeah, it could be digital, it could be non-digital, but I would imagine nowadays it could be digital.
So you don't have a class to donate it. That was donated.
Well, maybe somebody would donate it too, I don't know.
When we were opening and we were trying to find people and organizations to pay for different things, there was a agency that was going to pay for the sign up front, but they wanted their name on it, and we aren't allowed to have a name on it donated by.
It's a damn shame.
Yeah, so anyway, the intent was to have the sign up there, and that's how it failed. And signs aren't cheap. But the one, I don't know who mentioned it at the high school, that is a beautiful sign. But that's true, John, that to have something like that, and to have something in the back too, even if it's on the building itself.
Just as a simple, even a simple boy that just has it on there. Okay, anything else?
Nope, not under.
Any questions on building and grounds? Comments? No, we'll move into old business. Update the kick tires.
Yeah, so currently there's $59,272.05, and that's for that second van. So yes, I'm working on the proposals for three different companies to submit the cost of new equipment and moving. So you'll know when I know who gets picked and what's available to us. And I actually, we probably shouldn't even be calling a van, because those are really called buses now.
I understand we have a little problem with Plymouth Selection, and we're looking to, this is the last meeting, we're looking into somewhere else to...
There's a, Plymouth County has a bid list of companies that they have awarded purchases for vehicles. This is for anybody in Massachusetts. You have to pay to be part of it, but because the police department paid to be part of the Plymouth bid contract, we automatically can be part of it, so we save $200. And so there's, I think, four different businesses that have the van buses that we would be looking for. Well, that, I hope that they have them, that we're looking for. When looking at the one company, they didn't have anything for us to purchase. But on another note about transportation and vans or buses, our 1999 Dodge Caravan that was donated to us in 2007 was brought yesterday. Bob brought it for to have it inspected, and it failed because it needs to have a tie bar replaced.
Well, the tie rod and the connections and the joints for the tie rod were gone, and he said it's a safety. They failed it on a safety basis, so it shouldn't be driven at all, except maybe to a garage.
So we're not having it fixed. We got our time out of that vehicle. It was a used vehicle when we got it. We were very grateful to get it. We were pretty much using it to pick up items, to deliver a brown bag, those sorts of things. Also for handyman to use to go out and do handyman work. It's just, it wasn't a vehicle that we used to transport seniors. So I contacted Central Services to say, you can use this as surplus. And
Smith School couldn't repair it?
I'm sure they could, but do they want to? It's
good practice.
I could check. But again, if we're paying for the materials, I don't think it's worth the investment. I mean, it's a 1999 Dodge Caravan that has a lot of miles and a lot of wear and tear. And I personally don't like driving it either, because it goes in one direction. But as I said, it's really used for internal purposes, not for transporting seniors. So.
Well, it's too difficult to get in and out of if you're in any way handicapped or walking or, and some of the elderly ladies, especially that I transported with their van, who had trouble getting up the stairs of the van, could never get in that van. You've got to duck your head and step up, even with a little stairway on. If you put a little stairway out there, it would still be difficult to get in and out. So it was never used for transportation.
It was a great vehicle to have available to us. Again, it was donated. There aren't too many times that you have a vehicle donated. Grateful to have it, and I think we used it wisely and as much as possible, and it's not worth additional investment.
If the city can get any money out of it, is it possible that we could get our hands on those funds?
I would say if they were able to get something for that van, I could then request city council to have that money brought back to us, as I am doing with the white van. Yes.
Any other?
Did we find the handyman?
No, that job hasn't been posted. It's getting rewritten. So no, we don't have a handyman. As you all know, Bill Hubbard retired, being our handyman and our primary van driver. And he was the one who took care of all the vehicles, making sure they were filled with gas and had all the right maintenance done to them. So he is gone, and that job, the mayor did say that job could be reposted. So it's just rewriting the job description for that. And then also Anthony Everson, who left the fitness center, he's that position, I can, the mayor also approved it being reposted. And both of, well, both of those positions are really paid from Anthony's position, the fitness person, assistant, is paid through the fees from the fitness center, and then handyman was through the handyman payments, and then other monies that come in through the revolving account. So it's not city funds that pay for either of those positions.
Okay, anything else? Anyone questions? Okay, move on to new business.
Yep. So Highland Valley Grants, we applied for 3 different grants, excuse me, from Highland Valley, and we just received information letters that we received 1 grant. So they're funding the medical transportation, and 130 of it can be used for administration, and then the remainder, 3,120, can be used for the transportation itself. I sent the grant over to the mayor's office because all grants have to be signed off on by the mayor. So I'm waiting to get that back. So we, as I said, only received one grant out of 3. And the letter that they had sent, I thought this was, you know, they have only so many dollars. There was $79,100 available. And so the applications that they received 22, let me make sure I'm telling you the right number. 22 applications, 5 of which were receiving no funding. So of the 5, 2 of them are ours. So we only got 1 grant out of all of them, which was disappointing. But, you know, once the mayor signs it, we can get it over to Highland Valley and we'll have some of that money. Unfortunately, what costs us for that program is paying the person to administer it. But between the fees and the grant, the program can really, you know, continue, which I think is good.
Okay, any other?
I don't know. I don't have any other.
Okay, I don't have any other new business either. So, does anyone have any comments before we close?
I was unable to attend last month's meeting because of the work. Are we staying the same for a 1:30 time?
Oh, yeah.
We are.
Yeah. We looked into it, and it apparently very few people want to change it at all. If we were, I didn't hear anybody really pushing to change it. And one person wrote me that it shouldn't be changed to any later than 3:30 because in the winter driving is a little bit more difficult that hours. So I think 1:30 seems to be most convenient.
And also, what are we going to do about our members that keep being absent without calling?
We're working on getting them to either come in or resign or maybe be terminated.
So 2 actually have resigned.
2 have left already.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So we're down to actually 13 members out of our 15. We have 13 active members. So our quorum is now 7. We've been having trouble making our quorum at 15 because we needed 8.
Yeah.
And now we are able to make our quorum more easily, but we still have a lot of members.
So will you be able to fill those positions?
Yeah, I was just going to say that there's applicants that anybody can apply. Northampton citizens can apply through the mayor's office by filling out an application. And so there are individuals who have applied to be on this board.
Okay.
Have we been approved for the next year? You know, the people that, you know.
Oh, ask for it to be reappointed? I haven't heard that you haven't been. I can check on that for you.
Well, usually if we get sworn in, you know, it's kind of.
Well, it goes before city council, so I don't know if that's happened yet. I'll check on it if I have any question.
I think they send you a notice or a letter that you should report to the city clerk as well. Yeah.
But if there's a lot of them, she usually comes here. Wendy.
Oh, yeah. She has been very considerate to do that.
I went to her. I think I was the only one at the time, so.
I had a vote in also.
Yeah, I think there were four people who needed to get reappointed.
It's really not much of a problem, just report to the office.
I haven't heard anything.
And so hopefully whoever needed to get reappointed did the application and got it into the mayor's office, because they needed that. Yeah, so at some point soon we'll have 15 members again.
Right. Hopefully we can get more than eight of them to actually show up. At least eight, so we can vote on something. Yeah, so it's been a problem. And also, I did mention last time, and I want to reiterate this, that Jim Spencer had once one and brought it up, that it would be nice for people to be in the senior center more than once a month if you're on the board. Come in from time to time, have a cup of coffee, see what's going on. In other words, the more acquainted you are with what's, the classes we're having and what's going on here, the better we can advise Patty and the staff, which is what our job is.
And also to get on the volunteering list.
Yeah, to get on the volunteering list if you possibly, if you have the time. I know some do work, we have some members of work, and if you have a job, it's more difficult. Whatever you can arrange is good.
And I think it's good for you to be as familiar as possible with what the programs and offerings of the senior center, because I think it's a horrible reflection of us if one of our board members or one of our volunteers is asked what we do down here and the response is, I don't know. So, I mean, looking at our Facebook page, Joanne does a fantastic job. If you do any type of social media, you literally could glance at it once a week and be able to, like, you know, tell somebody what's going on and what's happening, because their tax dollars fund this building, they want to know what's going on, there might be something that might interest them. And you guys are walking, talking, marketing, so let's do it.
So that's, I've made that point before, along with attendance, so we'll continue to make the point. I think it's a good one. You see, I mean, we have Mary who's here all the time. I think she lives here. We're not sure about that, but there was a cop somewhere back then, you're suspicious of. But no, and the rest of us are here quite frequently, so.
I just wanted to mention the Pine Street Chronicle, the October issue. You should have gotten it or are about to get it in the mail. Joanne is the editor for this and puts it all together, getting tons of information from all of us on staff. So it's an important document, and when anybody says what's going on, it's like here. Mm-hmm. Or at the front desk, if there's a question, I said, always go to the Chronicle, because what you need to know is pretty much in there. And then, as you know, every other month we have the insert in the Daily Hampshire Gazette, and you know that's put in over 17,000 copies, and that's a way to let seniors know, but it also lets the community know who we are, what we're doing, because we rely on community support.
Well, every time I deliver these, every 2 months I deliver these to various businesses around, I always remind them that the next month there will be an insert in the Gazette. Most of them do get the Gazette. So, you know, so we're able to keep up with month to month instead of putting something 2 months ahead of time. So it's a schedule every month. And I like the schedule in the back. You can look up individual programs and you can look up times, what goes on each day, and also you can look up the programs itself. So it's a good organization. Thank you very much, Joanne.
And thank all the staff, too.
And staff and everyone else who was helping. Good. Okay, anybody want to know one more comment?
I noticed the holiday dinner is in December. You're going to set aside a block of tickets for out-of-towners.
We started doing that last year. We had 10 tickets that somebody from out of town could purchase. And yes, we will do that again. I would say we wouldn't do that if we were at capacity, but we aren't at capacity. So we can do that, 10 people from out of town.
And how, do you know how much it's going to be?
I do not.
Okay. You know when they're about when they're going to be
out
offered.
It's sometime in November. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you'll know more about that in November. I'll say they'll be available on November 1st.
How's that? Who's interested, so.
And I don't even think we did all 10 last year for out of towners, so it wasn't like
No.
Although it was a new concept, so maybe.
We didn't have a big crowd last year, which I don't think we did.
I think last year we started off with just North Hampton people and we added the out of town.
Yeah.
I think this year if we start off with out of town, probably be more popular.
So on Monday, November 2nd, tickets are available.
Is that for out of towns or?
For everybody.
Everybody.
Tickets will be available. And that typically is an event that's just for North Hampton seniors, other than the 10 tickets for out of towners, because that we pay fully for. We don't get turkeys donated to us. There's no one else putting it on for us, so it's all completely supported by the ticket sales. And that if there is any money that we use, and it's staff time and all of that, it is for North Hampton seniors. There's only a couple of things that we do each year that are strictly for North Hampton. Other than I can say for the holiday dinner, now it's 10 people from out of town. So people can start scalping those tickets.
Running through the hill down, waving. Come and get them. Maybe not.
We pay reasonable accommodations for caregivers and things like that. Like if somebody has a caregiver that they need to attend the event with them and their caregivers from another community, we've always made reasonable accommodations in the past. We're a very accommodating environment.
That's what I've heard.
I can't remember, is there musical entertainment at that?
Yes.
Yeah, there's entertainment, there's, usually you have a performer. And in the past, we've had the choir from JFK and or from one of the church, from where? St. Elizabeth's, Seton. Slash was St. Mary's slash Sacred Heart, so I think it's all combined now.
Just a suggestion, if you are going to ask Elizabeth and Seton, I would suggest getting in touch with the choral director and letting him know that you're extending the invitation for a visit.
Yep.
Yes, because I think in the past it's been that they already are booked, including JFK. So something we should start doing now, because, you know, before you know it, it's New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
It's true. Speaking of which, you know, we will be a New Year's first night location for people.
That's an afternoon meeting?
It's, yeah, they're usually here in the, well, we close at 12, city closes down at 12, but the building stays open and they have performances all through the day. And I think last year they were out by 8 o'clock.
Okay, and we have a motion to adjourn. And we have a second over here. Teresa? All those in favor? Anybody opposed? No one's opposed to leave.